Good evening, beloved. Welcome again to the Greater High Street Missionary Baptist Church Wednesday evening Bible study. We were out on last Wednesday, but we're delighted to be with you again on this Wednesday evening. What a joy it is. For those who are just joining us, we are at 1 Peter, the third chapter, and we shall begin our study tonight at that 8th verse. And of course, we are dealing with harmony in the church on tonight. And we're just so glad to have our members with us, those preachers and pastors who've been sharing with us, you know, across the years, and well wishes and friends, and those, you know, across the country, wherever you may be. It is a joy to be with you again tonight in this season of gratitude. Of course, every season is a season of gratitude, technically. But in this time that we celebrate Thanksgiving, where we especially emphasize and embellish the appreciation that we have for the goodness of God, for He is so good, His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endures to all generations. And so we're going to start tonight with 1 Peter, and just want to touch a bit on verse 7, 1 Peter, the third chapter, and then we'll be going forward as far as the Holy Spirit will allow, and beginning at verse 8. Let's have a word of prayer, and then we shall proceed with our class tonight. God, our Father, we thank you so much for this glorious time of sharing and studying and unpacking the writing of the Apostle Peter. And we just thank you so much. And God, as we study, may we not only be hearers and learners, but we'll be doers of the word as we live out our lives in these last and evil days. And tonight, as we study his admonition to the church and how we should live harmoniously in the church as bodies of Christ, as family. And, oh God, we just thank you so much as you lead us. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your anointing, for your leading us in this breathe word of yours. We just love you. We bless you. And be with us tonight. Thank you for receptive hearts and listening ears. In the name of him who is our Christ, we pray. Amen. All right. Again, for those who are just joining us, perhaps for the first time, or you've been out for a while, and certainly we encourage you to contact others, members of your family, children who are off in school, that they should be led by the Spirit, and that Christ still be the center and the circumference of their lives. They will not regret it. And so tonight we are, and it's on your screen, how to live in harmony. And of course, when we look at where we are in 1 Peter, we're looking at God's grace when we look at where we have come from. That is, we're living in hope, we're living in holiness, and living in harmony. And of course, when we live harmoniously, it involves submission one to another. And we have talked about submission to authorities. We have government, and God has ordained governments. And whether good governments or bad governments, we should submit to them, except when they order us or legislate some type of statute or law that would violate the law of God. And of course, then we must obey the law of God. And then we are to have this relationship, submission to employer-employee relationship, and how we are to interact one with the other, that we're not one superior over the other, but there is order. There is an order, there's a procedure, there's a process that one must go through in order to have a harmonious society. And of course, submission in the home. Nobody, we are all one in Christ in essence, but there is an order in the home in order for there to be harmony. If there's no order, then there is chaos. And whatever the organization may be, whatever it is that you're involved in, someone has to be the head. everything revolved around leadership, and then leadership casts vision, and then the implementation thereof will go filter down through the ranks. And so then that's the submission in the home, and tonight we'll be looking at the church, harmony in the church. And of course, most of us, even like me, you love music. And whenever there's discord, whenever there's maybe a key or an instrument that's out of tune, that is not in harmony, then it disrupts the whole piece, the whole presentation. And so this is what Peter is emphasizing tonight, that there must be harmony in what we do. And we just touch bases I just want to just look at where we were on verse 7, and this was it made it incumbent on the father, the husband, because we were touching base with how the mother, the lady, the wife should submit to the husband. But then the husband, in order to be harmonious and they are to dwell, then he is to be, submissive to her as well, to live with your wife in knowledge and honor your wife as the weaker vessel, as a joint heir. The reason, because failure to do so, to maintain harmony in the home, and there's discord and there's no tranquility, it will hinder your prayer life. This is the word of God. It can hinder your prayer life, and God will not hear in a disorder, a dysfunctional, in a disorderly relationship. And so we are to live even in difficult times. And so that's the man. It makes it incumbent on the man to protect her, to be the primary provider, to take the lead, to oversee the family and its welfare, and to be the driving force, and also to plow the way, to be the initiator. That's the, in order there for there to be harmony in the home. She's not to be the maid. She's not to be one to be abused of any sort. And she's not to be the one to be able to think like him. Sure, there should be compromise in the relationship, because I've shared with you before that too often, and many of us are guilty of it, to be sure, and that is want to try to get the other person to think like you, and the other person want you to think like them. God did not wire us up like that. He made us different, but we are to compromise for the best interest of the home, the family. And too often, homes are torn asunder because of the disharmony in the relationship. I move now to verse 8 and 9. And this deals with live at peace with others. I'll read that for you. Verse 8 of 1 Peter chapter 3 now. 1 Peter chapter 3. Finally, brethren, after he has gone through all of this harmony into authorities and family relationship, now he says, finally. He's dealt with the other things in a certain order. Now he says, finally, be ye all of one mind. That's the key. Be of one mind. Have a compassion one of another. Love as brethren. Be pitiful. Be courteous. So the issue is to be of one mind. Now there is harmony in diversity. That doesn't mean you are to elucidated on that. Be of one mind, have compassion, have brotherly love. These are the elements of that one mind we are to have. And also to have pity, to be courteous, and do not retaliate, but bless those who do evil against you. You got that? And this is how you're blessed. That's how you're blessed. Be of one mind. Have compassion. Have brotherly love. That's filio. Filio comes from the word Philadelphia. Filio, brotherly love. Have pity. be courteous, and do not retaliate. In verse 9, that is rendering evil for evil, or rallying, that is an attacking, for attacking, but be contrawise, but contrawise blessing. Contrawise, contrary, in the opposite direction. Blessing, knowing that ye are there unto call, that ye should inherit a blessing. This is the calling, that ye are called. That's the point. That we are called to be of one mind. We are called to be compassionate. That's our calling. That's our calling. You don't have the option. And then have brotherly love one to another. We ought to have, that's our calling, to have pity. And do not retaliate, but bless those who do evil against you. That's how you get your blessing, when you behave like Christ. And then don't retaliate, but bless, that is, forgive. You shall be rewarded. And so the world, but when the world, what kind of witness does it have, you know, for us as believers in Christ? The world is not to see the believer just arguing and bickering one to another. And don't take that home. You have an unbelieving husband or a relative or children or whatever. Don't take that home with you. That kind of behavior, bickering and biting and brawling and grumbling all the time, nagging and fussing, enticing, complaining, in division. That's not good for your witness. Our calling is to be better than that. That's our calling. And you feel better inside because you carry all of this cancerous stuff in you and eats at you like a cancer. When we should let it go, it's your calling. This is your calling, a calling to be blessed. Believers must keep their minds upon becoming just like Jesus. That's the calling. Upon being conformed to the image of Christ. It is to be conformed. Let that mind be in us as in Christ Jesus. Believers must keep their minds upon living holy, righteous, and pure lives. It's a challenge to be sure. None of us have been able to attain that. I stand before you as still in need of a better way, a stronger way, Christ's way. But I'm pressing on, I'm striving, but I'm better today than I was yesterday. And tomorrow I should be better. Because this outward man is perishing, but the inward man is being renewed day by day. Day by day. Look what he says, Romans 12 and 1 and 2. I'll read it, you know it well, but I'll refresh you. I beseech you, therefore, this is the part of the writing of the Roman, Paul. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is a reasonable service. It's reasonable. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. When you change your mind, you can change your attitude. You can change your life. You can change how you handle business. You can change how you react to your loved ones. You can change your situation, how you change your mind, how you process it, how you internalize it, how you react to what happens to you. You don't give other people the power over you to manipulate you, to make you angry and to react. You make a decision. You make a decision to act contrary to what is demanded of you, of your conversation. And so when you make those conscious decisions, it's quick. And that's what the devil likes to do. The enemy likes to hit you in an ungodly moment. And then you go off and do what is natural. Your nature called for. Who do you think you are? You don't know who I am. Yes, you are a child of God. You should behave like him. Believers must keep their minds upon developing spiritual character. And of course, Galatians 5, 22, 23, you know it well. the fruits of the Spirit, we should be, we are like a tree planted by the rivers of water. And then that tree is producing fruit. Fruits of love, joy, peace, gentleness, long-suffering, goodness, faith, meekness, and temperament. And temperance against such there is no law. So we have to be careful. And then, not only that, we must have compassion, sympathy. We must be compassionate one with the other. And this love that we have, the spiritual love that we have, it transcends the blood ties. Because many of you know that we have a close relationship with our sisters and brothers who are part of the body of faith that we have, and some of our own blood relatives. It would be good if both could work together. But oftentimes they do not. Some say, argue the fact that business and blood do not exist, but if it were done in a spiritual context as well as a blood context, then you are even blessed even the more. So compassion, it means to feel for others, feel, suffer when they suffer. Rejoice when someone else is rejoicing. It's not just you taking selfish all the time. Weep with those who weep and rejoice with those who rejoice, and understand the pressure that your leader is under. So much pressure. Can't satisfy everybody all the time. It's darn if you do and darn if you don't. When they one hurt and being criticized and attacked, you should come to the rescue. Come to the rescue. And when you agree with those who are sorrowful, verse Romans 15, and then I move on. We then, that verse 15 and 1, we then that are strong should bear, you're right, the infirmities of the weak. And then Romans 12, 15, rejoice with them that do rejoice and weep with them that weep. And then tenderheartedness, that believers must have pity for one another. Pity. That pity means to be tenderhearted and sensitive toward others. And then when we look at Matthew 11 and 29, he says, take my yoke. This is the yoke part of being yoked up with him. He take my yoke upon you, and then you have, it's a growing process, a learning process. You have to learn of me, and we should be growing every day. Not that I have arrived, no, but learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest upon your soul. Rest upon your soul. So my sisters and brothers, when believers, it's about a lifestyle. It's about the lifestyle, and that is, it's about a walk that we're called upon as children of the Most High. And we are to not to, and we're so quick to retaliate because we don't, nobody likes somebody to make a fool out of them. I mean, it's just, and then you're going to always have somebody that feel that they've got your best interest at heart. I wouldn't take it. No, I wouldn't take it for nothing. God, ain't nobody going to make no fool. I ain't going to take it. And if I was you, I would take it. But this is not the calling of God. He allows these testing, these situations to come into your life, the vicissitudes of life, to come into your life, that intersects your life, your pathway, for a purpose. He allows it. And when he allows it, then it's a testing. It strengthens your faith. It lets you know just where you are in him. What is your level of faith? What is it? And then when you retaliate, you feel so bad. Oh, I had to repent. I don't know how many times, but I've had to repent, really, because. But when you don't retaliate, you can be blessed. I don't care what they're saying about. I wouldn't take it. Even your friend, girl, or your buddy, your partner, I wouldn't take it. Look, when those who do evil against you don't retaliate, because this point here refers to both the believer and the unbeliever, because as tragic as it is to some believers to do evil, and rail against another. Believers are not to do that. Never to do that. No matter how the source of evil rattling against you, true believers are not to retaliate. But we tend to do that. And sometimes we do it so subtly. I'm going to pray for you, but so and so and so. This is a subtle form of retaliation that we do, and sometimes we do it under the disguise of prayer. So the believer is not to retaliate, not to return evil for evil. You can't put out fire with fire. You can't do that. You can't put out fire with fire. In the world that we live in the course of behavior between men, everyone tend to be mistreated. They react against one another time and time again. But as believers, the point is this. The believer is not to react against a person who mistreat them and does evil against them. There are at least two reasons why he or she is not to retaliate. Number one, reaction will most likely lose friendship. Retaliation. Most likely friendship will be lost to that person. And what it does also, it will lose an opportunity for you to witness, to let the love of Christ shine through. And as a result, you heap coals of fire on their hearts, and their cold, cold hearts. A Christian did, how the Christian may have done this to you, or a believer, we're never to retaliate, because reaction is not the way of God or Christ. Not to, because we tend to react, because the believer is to be blessed, bless those who do evil against them. And we know what that means to speak well of. It means to speak well of your persecutors. Do not react against them by cursing them out, speaking harshly, or striking out at them one way or another. We can do it so smooth that we do not try to hurt them either verbally or physically. On the contrary, we seek to find something that is commendable about them, and we commend them for it, not for the act in of itself. But then it's about your witness, because you're going to lose friendship. You will not show that you are Christ-like. You're not showing them the mind of Christ that is in you. We are just not to turn around and to try to do something and become persecutors ourselves. And look what the scripture says. But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, Matthew 5:44. What you're doing is, when you do that, you turn the account over to God, and then he will do the collection, and then you trust him for the results. No matter what others will encourage you to say, these advisors that we may have, maybe sometimes they mean well, but you're hurting yourselves, and you're circumventing your blessing, and you make dysfunction what God is seeking to take you to, and you circumvent that. And so it means to do good for those that persecute you. The believer who blesses those who do evil against them will be greatly rewarded. I'm a living witness. I move on now to love and enjoy life. In verse 10, 11, and 12. I'm going to get through this one. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain, his tongue from evil, and his lips that they may speak no guile. Let him eschew evil, shun evil, and do good. Let them seek peace and ensue it. Verse 12. For the eye, watch this, of the Lord are over, the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. Don't you think that God is unaware and what is happening to you is catching God by surprise? Step one, four steps here that we're looking at. Step one, stop your tongue. That's a dangerous little book. Stop your tongue from speaking evil. That's a ruddy little fellow. From speaking evil, from speaking deceitfully. Says step one. Step two, turn away from evil and do good. Turn away from evil and do good. It's not easy. We in this academic setting, but from a behavioral standpoint, it's really a challenge, I promise you. Step three, seek peace and pursue it. It's a pursuit. It's where you can really never attain in and of yourself, not in the flesh, but in the spirit. You pursue it. You go after it. It's always, it's a marathon. Always. Step four, remember the source of life, the Lord himself, the very source of life, the Lord himself. He sees and hears all things, even the innermost secrets of your heart. He is against evil. He's against evil. And so what the tongue, again, back up top to step one, the tongue of many people are ever so ready. It's a ready writer. Ever so ready. To react, to attack, to defend. Boom! So quick, that tongue. To rail, to poison, to cut, to hurt. You have to ask God to help you manage that tongue, because how many lives have been destroyed, homes have been destroyed, children have been hurt, and damaged, churches have split. Churches split because of the tongue, hurting one another, attacking one another, police having to come, and they end up in heathen courts. God forbid. So an evil tongue is a tongue that constantly cut and want to take the floor. I got the floor, to take the floor, to refuse instruction, to curse, to backbite, to argue, to interrupt and to disrupt others, to defend oneself, to retaliate, to gossip and to criticize. That tongue is a dangerous thing. A person is to keep his lips from speaking guile. The word guile means deceit. Deceitful tongue is a false tongue, a cheating tongue, a treacherous tongue, deceptive tongue. Watch your tongue. Tying tongue, lying tongue, mistreating and beguiling and a flattering tongue. Be careful, my sisters and brothers, in life. As we approach a close, but we have to seek peace. Peace. And pursue it. Believers not only to desire it, but to actively pursue it and go after it with all that you have. And you'll be surprised. It'll lower your blood pressure. It will it will have a physical manifestations. It'll bring calm to your life and to your spirit. The fact that it has to, you follow peace is not always possible sometimes. Some persons within the church are just troublemakers, just grumble sometimes, just complainers and gossip and criticize. And some leaders are self-centered. Sometimes it's not always easy. Some of them just have to be prayerful and go on. They're full of pride. And some within the church are just plain selfish and self-centered. But then he wants harmony in the church, be of one mind. And some persons within the world are troublemakers too at large, but we have to be careful. The point is, the believer is to follow after peace with all men, no matter who they are. And you find yourself at peace that surpasses all understanding. All of your cognitive abilities, it will surpass all understanding. And you can go to sleep at night in harmony. And so then, members, the source of life is the Lord God himself. No person has life apart from God, in him we live, move, and have our very being. We have no life apart from God. Why can't you, if you're thinking, you thank him for every day of your life, for all of his good and gifts of life. Mercies are new every morning. And so, my sisters and brothers, I prepare to leave you. God sees the righteous, the very person who has been described in this first three outline. God sees the person who controls his tongue, who does not speak evil nor deceptive to people. God sees the person who turns away from and flee from evil. And thirdly, God sees the person who seeks peace and pursue it. He sees, he knows, he loves you, and he cares. I think John 15 and 7 says, if ye abide in me and my word, and that's what we're doing tonight, abide in you, and ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. But you must abide in the word, abide in the ship. And then that's Hebrew 4 and 16, let us therefore come boldly now. Now we can come boldly unto the throne of grace, that ye may obtain mercy and find grace and help in the time of need. I got to close here, but let's start at next Wednesday. Well, that's coming up to Thanksgiving, so we'll give you a notification. We will suspend our Bible class on next Wednesday, but be prepared to read 1 Peter, the third chapter, and then we shall conclude the following lesson if the Lord allows. Amen. So again, we will not have Bible study on next Wednesday. We ask that you go with God. You know, be thankful. Enjoy Thanksgiving holiday. Be blessed and go with God and have love and harmony in your spirit. And don't let his blessing, his constant blessing, dull your gratitude. Be thankful. Be thankful. Be thankful. God, our Father, thank you so much for this time of sharing. Thank you for these nine people who studied with us tonight. May we not only be hearers and learners, but we'll be doers of your word. Be the center of our life. Be the circumference of our life. Protect us in our or in order our steps and our stops. Keep us and guide us in your will and in your way. We love you. We praise your name. In Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray and ask it all. Amen. Go with God.